Signore e signori, buonasera, benvenuti alla Casa Italiana Zerilli-Marimò della New York University. My name is Stefano Albertini, I'm the director, and I'm very pleased to introduce this event and our speakers for tonight. As you know, the event is originated by the publication in Italy of a book entitled Migrazioni, Migrations. And it's a book that deals with the presence, the African presence in Italy. And this gives me a chance to reconnect to another event that we did here 2 weeks ago, more or less, when we had the film of Fred Cuorno, Blaxploitalian, I always have problems pronouncing the whole thing, that is on the presence of Italians, of actors of African, but also of Latin American descent, actors of color, one would say, in Italian cinema. It was a very interesting and very thought-provoking and engaging film. And I'm very pleased that there is a sort of fil rouge that connects these two projects. One, of course, concerns cinema, and this one is on poetry. And it's a project that was coordinated by a Nobel laureate, the Nigerian poet Wole Soyinka. And it sees voices of Italian poets, of African poets, in a variety of different languages. And it really opens our eyes on the reality that Italy is no longer, if it ever was, this country with a monolithic culture and a monolithic race, quote unquote. But it's a country that is marked by a plurality of presences that, in my opinion, make it more interesting, more fascinating, and more beautiful. I was particularly pleased when Alessandra Di Maio proposed this project, because I believe that poetry is one of the great means of communication that we have to communicate among people of different ethnicities and of different culture. On some level, like music, because there is a language of poetry that goes even beyond the language in which the poem is written. So I was delighted that Alessandra edited this book and coordinated these efforts. And this book is also accompanied by photographs that we will see some of them. And this brings me to introduce our two presenters. Alessandra Di Maio is the editor of the book, and she teaches English literature at the University of Palermo. She had fellowships and honors in a variety of different American institutions. I just like to remember here her time at the Italian Academy for Advanced Studies at Columbia, where she actually worked on a project similar to this, or to the beginning of the project. And she teaches English literature and postcolonial studies at the University of Palermo. And with her, I'm pleased to welcome back to Casa Italiana Maaza Mengiste. I know that many of you are familiar with her and her work. Maaza is a novelist and an essayist. Her debut novel, Beneath the Lion's Gaze, was selected by The Guardian as one of the 10 best contemporary African books and received a variety of different other honors. She writes both fiction and nonfiction for New York, Granta, The Guardian, The New York Times, BBC Radio, Latra International. And she's currently working on her upcoming novel, The Shadow King, forthcoming in 2018. Maaza also has a very strong interest in photography. This is one other field that she covers in her scholarship and in her writing, and therefore she was the perfect person to present this project. And Maaza was here at the Casa for a variety of different events, and I always thank her for her intellectual generosity and for her will to share her knowledge and her very, very peculiar insight also on Italian things. So please welcome Alessandra Di Maio and Maaza Mengiste. Thank you.
Thank you, Stefano. Thank you very much for this generous introduction, and also for having so well, you know, summarized also the fields on which both Maaza and I work. And It's a pleasure to be here with you, Maaza.
Yeah, you know, it's good to be here with a friend, but also someone whose scholarship I admire a lot. And I mean, as soon as I heard about this book, I was really excited. Now that I've had a chance to look at it, and it's absolutely beautiful. We're going to have a conversation, but I have so many questions for Alessandra that I think I'll be asking the questions and she'll be answering, and you can ask me something later if you would like. But Alessandra and I went, how many years ago was it?
A few.
Maybe 5 years ago or 6 years ago to Lampedusa. And this is when I was living in Italy, and we met in Palermo, mm-hmm. and we flew to Lampedusa because we were both deeply invested, very interested and very concerned about the news that we were hearing about migration into Italy, and we wanted to see it for ourselves. And we can talk a little bit about that later, mm-hmm. but I always think of that trip, and I thought about it often as I was looking through this mm-hmm. book. I'm interested in hearing from you, what inspired you to start this project? And were you thinking of it when we were in Lampedusa 5 or 6 years ago?
Not really. I was thinking of doing something creating, after we went to visit Lampedusa, because I was, as you were, really fed up with the fact that the dominant narrative in Italy was all about how many people were dying in Lampedusa, how many people were surviving, you know. It was all about numbers. It was all about nameless people, and we didn't even know, where they were coming from, mm-hmm. what would happen to these people once they arrived in Lampedusa. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I felt, you know, and we talked about it when we were there in a very tentative way, I thought about different manners of telling these people's story, of talking about this exodus of mm-hmm. people coming from many places, but mainly from the four corners of Africa, because mm-hmm. in Lampedusa, most people who arrive in Lampedusa are from Africa, mm-hmm. right? That's a root, and roots are patterned in migration. But then this project came to life, actually, I think, you know, like after a few months, mm-hmm. and it came to life when, with Wole Soyinka, who's, you know, an Nigerian writer, an eminent Nobel laureate, but also more than a Nobel laureate, mm-hmm. right? If I may say so, he's a political activist, somebody who's in exile, in jail, who's always been a paladin of justice, as we say in Italian. We were talking about, you know, and I've had the honor and the pleasure to collaborate with him on different projects in the past 20, 25 years of my life. You know, in many ways, he was my mentor. We were really talking about diasporas and about, you know, the African presence in Europe. And I was always, always nagging him, saying, you know, there are so many Africans in Italy. African history is so embedded in Italian history, and we were talking about Hannibal and Othello and all these people who arrived, and Black Athena, and then it was La Nera Minerva. And thinking about it and connecting the past to the present, you know, he came up with this idea of having a festival in Lagos, mm. of all places, the largest city in Nigeria. And this was the Lagos Black Heritage Festival. Mm. And he said, you know what, let's dedicate it to the connection between Italy and Nigeria this year. Mm. That's what he said. And we did that, you know, so we had film screenings like 24/7 for quite a few days. We had different dancers and performances of all sorts, a theater, and we had an academic symposium. Mm. And he said, you know, what I really want to do is have, you know, like writers to tell their stories. Mm. So we thought about it, we sat down and we said, you know, how can we do it in a way that it's not boring yeah. for people who are not accustomed to mm-hmm. reading literature. And we thought that poetry is really what appeals to people of all generations, mm-hmm. right? So we commissioned short poems. They're like about 25 lines each, that they could be contained, you know, in a page, and it wouldn't take more than like 3 minutes to recite them, to to a bunch of poets, Italian poets and Nigerian poets. The idea was to put, you know, these poets in dialogue. And the idea also was offered by the fact that both the Italian literary tradition and the Nigerian literary tradition are really very rich. They're glorious literary traditions, and poetry is really important in both, on both sides, you know, of the Mediterranean. As Stefano was saying, you know, poetry is so evocative, it's so powerful, it's still a strong, forceful instrument of resistance and of denouncing, you know, events. Yeah. And so that's how we did it. You know, we said, let's see what happens.
Yeah, and I, you know, it also seems very fitting that poetry is the way to tell these stories of migration, because when I was looking through here, I think of migration as only really one moment in an extended life, that this is not a story that defines somebody for the entirety of their life. It is one moment, and they've had a life before, and then there's this period of migration, and you know, if they are lucky and if all works well, then they have a life beyond that they're not defined just by that moment. And so I think of migration as part of a fragment, you know, and it feels to me very fitting that the poetry becomes the way to describe a particular moment, that it's not necessarily telling a whole life, but it's talking about a fragment of a moment in something very concise and short. So I think that the structure of this, in a literary sense, matches, in a sense, the structure of migration, that it should be quick, it might be a profound moment, but you move on from it, and you go on to something else. So it really, it made sense to me that it would come through this way, in that. I wanted to talk a little bit, speaking of structure in this book, also about the way that you incorporated the Nigerian writers, there are Italian writers, there are photographs here. How did you make that decision to tell the stories from all these different perspectives?
Yeah. Well, first of all, I want to say, see how great it is to talk about something that you scholarly create with a writer, because you see things that I hadn't even seen. But you're very right, I think. Yeah. You know, it's a feedback of a different vision. Mm-hmm. These short poems are, in a way, passages, right? Yeah. They really represent the crossing, but they can open up and amplify voices in many ways. And so this is exactly what we tried to do. How did we do that? Well, we chose 16 poets, 16 Italian poets and 16 Nigerian poets for a reason. The title of this conversation tonight is "That Spake ORUNMILA." ORUNMILA is the god of divination in the Yoruba pantheon. So Wole Soyinka belongs to the Yoruba people, one of the major ethnic groups in Nigeria. And the Yoruba people, as many of you know, have a very old and ancient pantheon. And one of the big, you know, themes of Soyinka's work has always been, you know, like mixing all these gods. And of course, he's mainly a play, not mainly, but, you know, he's a well-known playwright, and you can do this on stage very well. And by the way, these poems were written, first of all, to be recited on stage. Then we decided to publish them, right? Because this is what poetry is about, seriously. It's about, you know, reading it, performing it. Reading it is not even the right word. So ORUNMILA, this pilgrim god, had infringed some laws, and in the Yoruba cosmos, even when gods when they infringe laws, they can be, you know, punished. So ORUNMILA, and just, you know, making it simple, of course, these are like legends and myths, especially which are like century and 1,000 years old. So Orunmila was sent to wander in the world looking for a home, looking for a refuge. Mm-hmm. And then, sure enough, you know, it was a woman who opened, you know, her place to Orunmila, and, you know, after he had, you know, paid his dues, basically, he could find a refuge. So Orunmila, in a way, is the god, or at least this is how Soyinka interpreted it, is the god protecting, you know, refugees, right? Mm-hmm. And Orunmila divines in 16 lines. Mm-hmm. They're not even lines, they're like between lines and syllables, but 16 is sort of a magic number of divination, let's put it this way. There's a lot of translation in this book, and perhaps we'll talk about it later. But so that's why we chose 16 and 16, but then in the end, there were 17 and 17, because Soyinka had encountered himself. I was telling him all the time, you know, we have a 17th poem here. No, no, no. Then he said, oh, well, you know, I don't need to be in the book. I said, what? You're the person who needs to be in the book. Because everybody was asked to write brand new poems. So these poets who collaborated in this project really were sitting and thinking, you know, and we had conversations, you know, email exchanges. It was really interesting, and I won't go too much into details. And then at that point, you know, when we figured that we had the 17th poem, we realized that for the sake of symmetry, we needed to have a 17th Italian poem. And then I said, I'm going to contact Dario Fo, who's, you know, the Italian Nobel laureate who unfortunately died just a few months ago. And he was absolutely excited. I have to say that the generosity, the enthusiasm that I received by all these poets was really amazing. It really blows my mind even today. And so Dario Fo, you know, I talked to him, he couldn't hear anything over the phone, so he would say, okay, can you talk to Franca? And then Franca, unfortunately, wasn't alive any longer. So, you know, he said, you know what I want to do? He said, I could give you a sonnet, that's what he told me, but I would like to give you two images, two paintings. I can send you the paintings, but I would like to, yes, good point. She was looking at that. I would like for you to consider, sorry, it's gonna be,
that's at the very end.
Yeah, it's there in alphabetical order. Oh, here we go. So he said, these are paintings that I made. Dario Fo was also a painter that I made about the connection, the historical connections, political connections between Africa and Italy. And so that's what he did, you know, and he gave us this. And, you know, we had them in Nigeria, and then, you know, we photographed them and we put them in the book as if they were another poem, because in a way, you know, this is what he does, he incorporates, you know, words and images, which is what this book is about. Yeah. So we soon enough realized that we really wanted to have a parallel narrative, which was the photographic narrative, mm-hmm. which was the visual narrative in this book. So in every poem, there was at least one very powerful image. Like, I'll show them the Abani one.
Yes, yeah? Yes.
And let me show this to you. And so we decided every poem had to be accompanied by an image, especially because we wanted, honestly, to talk also to younger generations, and younger generations are really very visual. Mm-hmm. You know, they think that we're old because we're on Facebook, they're all on Instagram and Snapchat, and they're really very visual. They really respond to that visual narrative. And so we said, why don't we do that? You know, photography is so powerful. And it was also a way of re-narrating, you know, migration as it is differently from the way it is proposed by the media. You know, we all have in front of our eyes these images of boats with, you know, mainly black bodies, all like cold, mm-hmm. you know, freezing, arriving on the Italian, southern Italian shores, or, you know, these dead bodies. We wanted to show, you know, different images. You know, migration is about so many things, as mm-hmm. you said. It's not just about the passage. It's about what life was before, what life is going to become after, who's coming with you, what you're leaving behind. So this is the first poem and image actually of the book. The book is divided into two parts, Afro with the 16, you know, Nigerian poets, and then Italia. Mm-hmm. And every poem is accompanied by a translation in the opposite language, so English, Italian, or Italian, English, and by an image. Mm-hmm. So this is Chris Sabani cartography.
Yeah, I think that the use of photography in here is particularly powerful because I, like you were saying, when we think about the images that we that have come to identify what migration is right now, we see those boats, we see the plastic boats, we see the bodies that are covered up with plastic bags. I think the ones that seem to break through the bombardment of images are the ones that are the most shocking, mm-hmm. like Alan Kurdi, the little boy mm-hmm. that was on face down on the beach. So that will also rise to the surface, so to speak. But in the midst of that, you know, I've struggled a lot with the purpose of those kinds of photographs and helping us to understand what it means to be in exile and what it means to be forced to leave your home and travel knowing that death is likely, you know, in term, and you're going somewhere and there's no guarantee that you'll reach it, and once you reach it, whether you will be accepted. There's so many steps to that, to this issue of migration, and what we tend to get in the photographs are they're usually at the end of their journey. They're usually just getting mm-hmm. towards Europe at that point. And there's a whole other experience that we haven't begun to understand yet. On one hand, those images, and it's taken me a while to actually get to this point, to say that the images that we have seen that have been the most shocking, maybe we do need to be shocked. Maybe that is a purpose, you know, maybe that reaction at some point did serve a purpose to make us aware and to keep it in keep this issue in our minds. But what do we do after the shock? And if we don't do anything with that, if we don't understand that it's more complicated than that most shocking moment that we have witnessed, we are shrinking these lives to only one moment. And we really need to seek and search out the rest of the story. And for those who are writers and those who are academics and those who are artists, we need to be engaged in developing those other stories. And I think that's what makes this book to me so important, that we are getting parts of these other stories. Like, for example, this by Chris Sabani, the first line of the poem, can we have, of cartography, is there is no native land. And that's the first sentence. And when I first read that, I just kept reading that line again and again and again. There is no native land. And when you begin a conversation about migration like that, you shift the entire dialogue of what will follow. And you paired it with that photograph, mm-hmm. which is incredible. We're all on a journey in one way or another. We're all from places. What do we call native land? How far back do we go? And this is negotiating with history and place and time just in that one sentence. And I really love that.
Yeah, and I'm really glad that you like this, because this might very well be one of my favorite poems. I'm not supposed to say that because, you know, I made a selection. So more poems, actually, more poets were involved in this project. And then I had the horrible role of having to say no to some of them. A couple of them are not even talking to me anymore. But, you know, we will make migrations 2.0, 2.0, I told them. But this is one of my favorite poems. I think that it really gives an idea, and perhaps it's got to do also with Chris Sabani's personal history, which is, you know, very intense, very mm-hmm. controversial. And you know, we're always on a platform. That's how we decided to put the photograph, you know, of these tracks and these shall I put it back for a second, of this house in the back with the mountains. And we really can't even imagine if the house is abandoned or not. Mm. We don't know if there is life or not here and where these tracks lead. And I think it's also beautiful to see how it ends.
Yes.
I mean, there is no native land, let there be love. You know, in, it's very idealistic, if we like, but and very optimistic, but at the same time, that's really the only way out. And this is what this book is about. It's about having choral narratives, choral visions. Even though, you know, we chose the poems following certain parameters. Mm-hmm. We contacted poets from different generations, from different regions of Italy or different regions of Nigeria, who would speak, you know, different dialects and languages, and who had also, you know, like engaged with other languages. On the Italian side, for instance, there is a poem by Cristina Lifara, another one by Fabiana Alborghetti. Cristina Lifara is of Somali origins, an Italian writer. Fabiana Alborghetti is Swiss-Italian. And, you know, same thing on the Nigerian side. And this was the idea of hearing different stories, of seeing different images. I wanted to show something else. So you might recognize this. This is still from Terra Ferma. Mm. From a movie. You know, it's a bit of a Madonna-like look, you know. Not a controversial movie, but you know, everything is controversial when you talk about migration. The only thing that is not controversial is the news. And this is really what we wanted to engage with, you know, like, let's talk about all this in a different way.
Yes, and I think there are many people engaged in trying to change the vocabulary with which we talk about migration, or people who are moving from one country to another. And I think books like this help. It's also been, I have to say that in the last few months, having witnessed what seems to be a seismic shift in the discourse that's been going around the world regarding migration, regarding immigrants, refugees. I've been thinking about the place of literature and the place of art in that discourse. How do we break through? Those of us who are invested in this, not only people who are creating the work, but people who are engaged in looking and reading, how do we begin to break through the noise in some ways? And it feels like it's only getting louder. I'm really, you know, it's a tough question, but I'm wondering, as you were creating this book, you had to have been aware of everything that was the rhetoric, the politics that seems to be rising up. What were some of your thoughts?
How much time do we have? We've talked about this many times, so it's actually interesting. You know that, you know, we worked for a couple of years, you know, on this book, you know, contacting people, trying to see what could create really a counter discourse. And on the other hand, this book was published in Italy at the end of October. And this was really the peak of a new era, in a way. Not only because of what's happening in this country. You know, I went to see, did I tell you, I went to see Ellis Island again on Saturday after 20 years. It was very interesting for me to go back now in this moment of history. And I realized something very obvious to all of you, I suppose, that, you know, the United States has had a very zigzagging narrative about migration. You know, I've been in and out of this country for 20 years, and the narrative was more homogeneous than it's been in the past 100 years, right? Mm-hmm. But also, when we talk about the Mediterranean, because this book is really about what I called some years ago the Black Mediterranean, the crossing, you know, from Africa to Europe, something new is happening. And I don't know, you know, if this is being covered by the American media, but something like 10 days ago, actually a new treaty was signed by Libya, or, you know, the nation that is now recognized by the international community as Libya, which is already complicated. You know, what is a nation? What is Libya right now? And Italy, and Libya actually is the most important commercial, you know, trade partner for Italy. It's been for a long time on migration regulations. So, in fact, there are no rules, right? There are no rules in the sense that these people who are crossing the Sahara Desert, in most cases, coming from West Africa, East Africa, in some cases also from South Africa proper, you know. They cross the Sahara Desert, they arrive in Libya, as we know, and then in Libya they have been detained for months, in some cases up to 18, 20 months, in camps, you know, let's call things for what they are, camps, detention camps. And then they, you know, they're made to board and to cross the sea on mainly the decrepit boards like the ones that we saw in Lampedusa. And many of them do not get to the Italian shores. They usually go to Italy, to Sicily, because Sicily is right there in the middle of the Mediterranean. So it's really a short trip. And there are some marine streams that, you know, when the weather is okay, can lead these people from Suara, Libya, to Lampedusa, which, by the way, even if it belongs administratively to Sicily and therefore to Italy, is much closer to the Tunisian coasts. So these people arrive when the weather conditions are fine, you know, in a bit more than 24 hours. So this has happened for like 30 years. Although the media has been talking, I've been talking about this, especially in the past, what, six, seven years maybe? This has been going on for like 30 years, actually over 30 years now. And this was possible because there was an agreement between Libya and Italy, between Berlusconi and his friend Gaddafi, right? They were best friends until Berlusconi sent, you know, bombs there, and you know, and we know what's happened. Libya provides Italy with all its gas. So there is a, how do you call that, an undercurrent pipe, huge pipeline, an amazing big one that really provides gas to almost all the country. You know, in the north we also receive some from Eastern Europe. So you can imagine the level of interest, of economic interests that there is there. Libya, of course, is one of the countries that, of the nations that has never signed the Geneva Convention. So you know, it was possible to make some illegal agreements. And they made this restitution treaty at some point in 2000, I think, in 2005. Restitution refers to the post-colonial present, because Libya was once colonized by Italy, right? So the idea is, okay, we're providing us, you're providing us, you know, different things, weapons, and then you know, we can send you migrants. And at some point, when Berlusconi, you know, under pressure of the NATO, was saying, okay, stop, this can't happen, not to this extent, famously or infamously, Gaddafi, you know, talked to the media, you know, he was very present in Italy. One of his sons was playing for Juventus, a soccer team, and he said, I'm gonna make Italy black. La faccio diventare nera, which is also a pun in Italian, and you know, there were like, for weeks, there were news covering these events. So now everything has changed in the sense that there's no longer Berlusconi, there's no longer Gaddafi. This treaty is still alive and kicking, because you know, it's not that you can erase treaties like this. But 10 days ago, Gentiloni, the new prime minister, you know, had to made this agreement with Libya. And this is, again, controversial because Gentiloni is the prime minister. He is, you know, he's liberal, progressist, was the foreign minister before. And so some people felt very betrayed by this. On the other hand, Libya and Italy have a very strong trade relationship. So this was, in a way, pressured by Europe, by the European Union, that has, which has always, you know, criticized Italy for letting everybody enter. It was, you know, like the product, the consequence of the European pressure to try to regulate somehow immigration to Italy or to Europe, for that matter. But how do you do that? Yeah. You know, how do you do that if it's all illegal? Yeah. Then there are people who say, this is not only legal. There are people who arrive from different parts of, you know, the Mediterranean basin, including Africa, through, you know, the Alps, or, you know, who are refugees. So they seek asylum, so they are not illegal. But the point is that there is a law, and there are many ways of infringing the law, mm-hmm. as we all know. Mm-hmm. So, you know, what is the real narrative?
Yeah, and I think what we tend to get is the most simplified narrative. And really that narrative is fueled, no pun intended, I'm sorry about the gas, speaking of gas, but it's really fueled by fear.
Absolutely.
Europe is very afraid, and it's very afraid because what do we keep seeing? We keep seeing these overloaded boats, and we see faces, and they are tired, they are hungry, they've been abused, they are desperate, and there is no distinguishing between one human being and another. It's a mass. And Europe's big fear, I think, is very similar to what America's biggest fear is a bunch of black people all of a sudden getting together and heading in your direction. That's scary to a lot of people. And we keep seeing those photographs again and again, and we keep seeing the same rhetoric. But I think that this kind of, these books like this, and I think the films, let's say, like those made by Dagmawi Ymir, who is an Ethiopian living in Italy. He was also one of the people that made the trek from Ethiopia through the Sahara, and he was imprisoned in Libya, made it to Italy, and now is a filmmaker telling not only his story, but the story of others who made it through that same journey. We are getting those voices coming through. But right now, that fear has come back because that rhetoric is increasing again. That it's a rhetoric of violence. And it makes me grateful that this is there, because if we are talking about this, and if this book exists, and these photographs are there, then it's at least some step in the right direction. I've been paying attention to, on social media, the website for MSFC, Médecins Sans Frontières, SEA, and they did something really interesting not long ago. They were taking photographs. They have a photographer. They were taking photographs on the ships, on the boats, where there were a bunch of people that needed help because the boats were sinking. So MSF was there to rescue them and bring them onto their boats. And
I think we have a couple of this. Let me see if I find them.
Yeah, let's see if we have.
I look for them.
Okay. But the way that MSF wrote about this rescue was, we have 250 guests on our boat, and we are so happy that they are here, and we will make them comfortable until they can now move somewhere else and continue their journey into Europe. But that idea of switching from the word migrant to guest created an entirely different narrative. And they have been consistently speaking that way. And the first time I saw it, I was shocked. I said, oh my gosh, guest? And I wrote them right away. I said, thank you so much. Thank you for just that word. But it let me see, if we just started, if we made that decision to change a word, it changes how we approach the situation. And it was really moving. And they continue to do that. It was great.
Yeah, language is very powerful, as we know. And about the word guest, you know, there is, it's a connoted word, let's put it this way, in Europe. You know, in Germany, the idea of the Gastarbeiter, right, of the of people of Turks, of Turkish origin who came as immigrants and worked as such, you know, as in a way second class citizens. So the word guest there has a specific connotation. You know, Derrida wrote about hospitality, you know, what is being a host, what is being a guest. So it's been really very much part of the discourse. And I think that the way that Doctors Without Borders use it is really very, very interesting, very beautiful. But definitely, you know, this is part of this project. Mm-hmm. Language is a powerful instrument. That's why we wanted really to match these two narratives, the visual narrative and the rhetoric, which is also in the oldest, you know, in the most traditional Latin sense, based on the word, right? Yeah. The power of word, which is also very crucial to, you know, West African culture, right?
Yeah.
So this is exactly what we tried to do here, because in a way, we thought that these two narratives could really back up each other and make, you know, the discourse more powerful. And choral, this is the thing that I will never get, you know, tired of emphasizing. You know, in order to have somehow fuller, more convincing, more realistic, more human narrative of migration, we have to have different visions and we have to listen to different voices because it's so fragmented.
Yes.
I love the word that you use, you know. This is a fragment. Each one of these pieces is a fragment. The narrative is so fragmented that if we don't stitch it together by listening to different voices, by watching different visions, what are we going to make of it, you know? And so there is on the one hand the necessity to talk about, you know, what happens in the crossing, in what, you know, some Moroccans call the burning of the Mediterranean. You know, there is death, but there is warfare, and there is, you know, expectation and asylum seeking and looking for freedom, for peace, for democracy. And then what happens is another story sometimes. But also, migration is something as old as the world, right? That concerns all, you know, creatures, like these crows in flight. And I wanted to show you this, for instance, you know, like crossing the desert has always been an important narrative, you know, also for Sicilians, for instance, not just for, you know, Africans, because we were part of Africa for a long time, right? Southern Italy was occupied by the Moors, by Tunisians, basically. So, How do we talk about this politically? On the one hand, you know, I was just boring you with all the Libya, Italy treaties. But on the other hand, what happens to all these people, to these men and to these women who cross the sea? Many of them are minors. I remember when you were in Rome, you worked very much on this.
Yes.
Now, this past year, statistically speaking, most people who crossed the sea were minors.
Yes.
Something like 72%, they're saying, you know? So what happens to them? You know, they're young people. So, you know, how is this story related, for instance, to that of their parents who, you know, went from, you know, a village, a rural village to a town? You know, what happens to them? What do they think? What do they expect when they cross the sea? So, you know, there are like different levels also on an existentialistic, you know, level in a way.
I want to open this up for questions from the audience, but the one thing that I would like to say also is I think you're asking some really, really good questions, and it reminds me of when we were in Lampedusa. Mm. And when we were there, remember we were talking to the Coast Guard people at and they said, well, if you want to wait for a little bit, there's a boat coming. I didn't think it would be that easy, but we were there. All of a sudden, we were just on the edge of the shore as a boat was coming in. And I remember it was really emotional, I think, for both of us to see that. It was troubling and moving and something that I don't think I will ever forget. And the one thing that struck me, the women with the babies that kept coming out of the boats, how many there were, the children that were there. But another thing that struck me was, I don't know if you remember this, but there were people dressed in really nice clothes.
They were all dressed up.
Dressed up as if they were on their way to somebody's dinner for a party. And this is from those boats that were in danger of sinking. And so they had to be rescued, some of them. And I was so struck by that. And I, not long afterwards, I wrote a piece about our trip there. And I was looking through old newsreels, Italian newsreels of ships coming in. And I found our friend, Dagmawi Ymir, randomly caught by the news, Italian news, as his boat was coming onto shore. He was just one of the many faces. And I couldn't believe it.
Yeah.
And I contacted him and I said, you know, Doug, he was wearing a brand new clean shirt. And I know his story of how he had been in Libyan prisons. He had been beaten. He was abused. He has been through the Sahara. He had been mistreated by human traffickers. Yet here he was in a clean green shirt, looking terrified and exhausted, but his shirt was clean. And I asked him, I said, Doug, you know, I noticed this also at Lampedusa, that people were dressed well, and you were dressed well. How is this possible? And he said, you know, they saved one outfit, or he borrowed that shirt from a friend who let him borrow it. He said, because they wanted to make sure that when they stepped on Italian soil, they did it as human beings again. And I think that for me said everything. That told me we're not hearing their stories.
Absolutely.
We're not seeing that search for dignity that we just assume we have, but when you get on a boat, it doesn't disappear.
Yeah. No, absolutely, and it's interesting also that Dagmawi Ymir got that footage for his first documentary, Come un uomo sulla terra. Did you show it here? I remember, no? Like a Man on Earth, he really got the footage. So, you know, when we showed it actually in Florence at NYU Florence, like a year and a half ago, and I invited him and Andrea Segre for the Black Italia series, they said, okay, you can stay here, we don't want to watch it. And to me, you know, knowing the story at that point, knowing him, it was a completely different vision. I mean, the movie, the documentary is very powerful in the first place. But when I had him here, and then he said, okay, we're going for a smoke outside, you know, it was uncontrollable, you know, I was really very moved, like we were in Lampedusa. Yeah. And I think it's got to do with the fact that then, you know, you meet people, and then you don't think, when you meet people, you don't think about their story.
Yeah.
You know, when you become friends and you share stories and you understand this, they become human, you know? We become human. It's all about, you know, like sharing stories, and all stories are true, all stories are similar, all stories are different, right?
Yeah.
So I really think that what you're saying is really, it's really an element, you know, what we're trying to do here. You know, what is that makes you, you know, a man in Doug's cases? Mentioning Ellis Island, third floor, there are all these garments. So it's the same story repeating itself.
Yes.
They all came here, and those were third class passengers, right? Mm-hmm. All dressed up.
Yes.
Most of them, of course, it's on all the time that it always happens. But, you know, they were always, you know, coming with the same idea of beginning a new life. There is a very interesting article by Stefania Pandolfo, who's an anthropologist at Berkeley, who talks about the burning. You know, this is how they, some people in North Africa refer to the crossing of the sea, right? And she says that the burning has eschatological implications, but she compares this to the phenomenon of suicide bombers, you know, how you basically renounce a life, you know, you give up your previous life in order to have a new life, you know. Theologically, even she explains that this might have, you know, in the Muslim, you know, vision of the world, assuming that there is only one, and of course this is not the case. There is an implication, and that's the idea. You know, it's like I'm going towards a new life. So, you know, I know that you want to open the floor, and I think we should, but I just wanted to show you a very short poem by Stefano Benni, which is a very hopeful, beautiful poem, I think. Stefano Benni is, you know, a well-known writer in Italy, and he's also written poetry, but he's mainly, you know, a novelist, and he does political satire. And I really wanted to ask him to write for this book for a number of reasons, because he has a different voice, right? He can be very, very political. And this is what he came up with, Stefano Benni, Children. With an English title, it wasn't Bambini, it was Children. And so we got this picture, you know, with this photograph, we decided to match this poem with that. And here you have it. In my story, there's a wolf. In your story, there's a lion. In one story, there's a white seal. In another, a jade dragon. But if I tell you mine and you sing me yours, they're pretty much the same. Then there is a story written by grown-ups about a man who never loves, who grabs all the storybooks, tears them up, and throws them in the fire. And he doesn't want me to read your words or you to read mine. What he wants is to build a wall so we can speak. I shout my story louder and you sing yours louder, and the lion and the wolf and the white seal and the jade dragon go and meet in the park, and don't let anyone tell us they can't hang out together. I think it's a beautiful filastrocca. I just changed the word barrier because in Italian it's muro, right? And I thought it was perfect. It's really a wall. You know, I read it like in these past few weeks and I was like, oh my God, it's really about that. But yeah. So yeah, if there are any comments, questions.
I have one, and it's for both of you. And it's not about the book, but it's about the documentary by Gianfranco Rosi, Mare, that was one of the nominees for Best Documentary at the Academy Awards. It didn't win, it doesn't matter. It's a great documentary.
Maybe won.
What really struck me in that documentary is that, aside from the very personal style of Rosi, that he chooses documentary footage, and then he tells a story, where these images serve the purpose of the narrative that he creates, but they're all true to life. Mm. And the thing that really made a great impression on me was that there are two parallel worlds in Lampedusa. And one is the world of the immigrants, and the other one is the world of the people who live on the island, and they never meet.
Yeah.
This is a change, obviously, because when things started, probably when two of you visited, it was still very much mixed, and the immigrants had access to their locals. And now it's like sanitized, and it's no contact at all. They're in the centri di raccolta, and they're brought either to Sicily or in other parts of Italy to be then distributed over different centri di raccolta. And the interesting thing is that there is only one character that deals with the Lampedusani and with immigrants. There's this fantastic doctor, the physician,
Bartolo,
who was here for the screening of Pocomare. And I was wondering, in your book, on the other hand, you have these, the Nigerian and the Italian, you mix the photographs with the text, you choose an African photograph for an Italian poem, I wanted to know something about your approach that seems different from the one that Rosi selected. This separation and this sanitation imposed on the island, and knew that through the words and through the images and photographs, tried to bring them together.
Yeah, that's exactly what I did in this book. I tried to have all these stories intertwine and create a sort of a new narrative. I think Rosie's documentary is really more of a docu-fiction, as he also said at the end, because it is true on the one hand that on a political level, there are two worlds that do not talk that much to each other in Lampedusa. But you know, there is the centro d'accoglienza, as they call it, and there is the community. The community is a small community. It's 5,000 people. In the summer, there are more. In the winter, you know, even like younger people go and study at the university. I teach at the University of Palermo. I have some students from Lampedusa. Lampedusani feel much closer to Palermo than to other cities in Sicily, also because they fly there, 3 flights a day. But on the other hand, so for instance, in August, July, August, migrants are really kept in the center, and this is a centro di prima accoglienza, so people stay there for no more than a month. But if you go in November, as I did this year, actually, I finished actually proofreading this book there, and it was important for me to do that. You see that some of these people, these young men especially, you know, they just, you know, go for a walk in the afternoon, and some of them go back to the center. You know, when the season, the touristic season is over, there is still a lot of interchange between these two communities. And this is, you know, like the actual story, but Rosie's documentary, and I know you were in conversation with him and the Italian Cultural Center, so, you know, you can say something more interesting than... you know, that comes from your conversation with him. But in my opinion, his artistic agenda is really very interesting because of that, because he's saying, you know, how can we combine these narratives while they are so irreconcilable? You know, it's like this double striving, this double consciousness. And I think he really reflects that very well in his docu-fiction. Basically, not offering any solution, like this is how it is, and I think that's what makes it powerful.
I found the film visually stunning. You know, really, it's powerful on many levels, and it was one of the things that I mentioned that I did speak to him about was that I was struck, and this was my point of criticism of the documentary. That when I got to the end, that little boy had an entire life. He had a name, but I've become stuck on this, that all those people on those boats have names. And I wondered about the decision, even at the end in the credits, they weren't named there at all. And so what do we begin to see? And this is, you know, what do we begin to understand of their stories if what we see of them is the weeping and the fear and the praying, but we don't even have a name to attach to that, because a name is everything. And that, for me, was a big blank spot in that film. He and I talked about it during our conversation, and one of the things that he talked about it was he had limited time, quite literally, you know, and on that boat, and it was very difficult. Yeah. It's a question, though, that I think we have to begin asking when we get accounts of people who are on those boats. What is their name? Give a name. Reporters can do that. Photojournalists should be able to do that. What is their name? And if we begin to insist on that, I will email. They don't like me when they get the emails, because I will email and say, can you please tell me who this is? Mm-hmm. Who are they? And that's it. And maybe at some point it begins to kind of register. Let's give these people, a name is attached to a place, it's attached to a family, it's attached to a history. They didn't leave everything when they stepped on that boat. And that was that was my biggest question about the documentary. Beautiful. But yeah, that was
And that's when he started to say that it's also docufiction, and you know, and it's true. Everyone has a story to tell, and you know, a way of looking at this. And he was really in Lampedusa for 1 year to work on this. So, and obviously, you know, we also come from a different background, you know, and different awareness of these issues. And you were mentioning Dagmawi Ymer. He made this short documentary. It's what, 6 minutes? Mm-hmm. And all you see is like all the names of these people from the Horn of Africa, mainly Ethiopian Eritreans, I think, right? Who died crossing the sea. All the names that he could put together. So you see this image with the sea in the background. I don't remember the name of the documentary.
You can find it on YouTube. One. But there was this huge... what's the word in English? The shipwreck? Is it a shipwreck?
Naufragio, sì, shipwreck.
And it was in October of a few years ago when 300 people drowned. Yeah. I think we all remember that.
But over
500.
Like October 3rd.
Yeah. And Dagmawi found out their names and made this documentary, which lets you know it's not that difficult to do that. And he made this beautiful film. Yeah. We're just saying everyone's name that drowned in both Amharic or Tigrinya, and then translating the meaning into English and Italian as well, so you understand who some of the people were. It's absolutely beautiful. If you can find, you will be able to find it online.
And they were all Ethiopians and Eritreans. Yes,
there is a question. You had a question too.
You talk about the rhetoric, the media rhetoric, government rhetoric that dehumanizes refugees, and they don't have names. It's part of the dehumanization, which you can use to create an environment to hate people. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. As soon as you put a name on a person, a human, it's more difficult to humiliate them. So the actual plan is to not give these people names.
Yeah.
Is to put them in a group and to continue the process of dehumanizing them from their trip from their homeland, across the water. Process, maybe you'll get a name. So your point is excellent, because if you want to take these people and humiliate them constantly, from the concentration to from the tents to the processing place, you don't give them names. You know? And if you keep working on that process of reminding us that these are human beings, then maybe we can get past these problems. We still even forget the question of why they're getting on these boats and coming over. What makes a person take their child and get on a boat and leave everything behind? So we forget about this. We can't forget about this. And we try to humanize each other. Mm-hmm. What would take you to leave everything behind? And go somewhere where the language is different, the culture is different, the food is different, everything is different.
Right.
It takes a lot of courage.
Yeah,
and absolutely.
About that part.
Yeah.
So the naming of people is the first part of keeping all of these people And I just want to, and the same thing with the refugees coming from Syria. Mm-hmm. You see the same pattern of dehumanization of these people. These are human beings, and we can't forget them.
There's been not long ago in an Italian newspaper or magazine, I read about this forensic scientist who has been working with people who don't survive. You might know exactly where I'm going with this. And what she discovered is many people on their way, before they get to Italy, they will burn off their fingerprints so they can't be identified, so that where you land is where you stay, but this is a way not to be identified in Italy. You can move elsewhere. But then the people who don't make it, who don't survive the trip, the scientist has been taking care of their bodies and trying to figure out a way to identify them, which is a whole other thing, and finding that they are taking the soil from their home. And before they leave, they sew it into their clothes. So that becomes a way to be identified if they don't make it. But it's also a way to bring home with you wherever you end up. And I was really struck by that. I wish I could find that piece. I'll send it to you. It was in maybe Internazionale.
I think right? I met this woman actually that you're talking about, because there is a huge trial going on in Agrigento, exactly, you know, like about the shipwreck by October 3rd, from October 3rd. Okay. You had a question.
Yeah, Alta.
No, but you can get it on Amazon, you know, on any,
Okay, and then I have a question about the translation.
Right.
And pardon my ignorance, so it sounds like a lot of the writers, maybe all of them, speak Yoruba, or, you know, I'm wondering if they're writing in English.
They're all writing in English.
You were correcting, you know, the barrier versus the muro.
Yeah,
was the Italian brought straight from English, or?
That's a very interesting question, and I'll try to give you a short answer, because I could talk about it for 2 hours, as I'm also a translator, and actually I translated Soyinka's latest works into Italian in this past year. But first of all the Nigerian poems are written in English, because that's, you know, like the major official language in Nigeria. But the people who wrote these poems are from different ethnic groups, you know, so there are Igbo poets and there are Yoruba poets, people from minorities, you know, poets from everywhere in Nigeria. But they all wrote their poems in English, because that's the language of their art. So what I did was I contacted quite a few Italian translators, you know, some of them, Andrea Sirotti, Paola Splendore, who are specialized in translating poetry and African poetry and Nigerian poetry. Sirotti is the one who just translated Chimamanda Adichie, right? Or Paola Splendore translated Warsan Shire, you know, made known in this country, especially by Beyoncé. So, you know, this was the idea. People who know how to translate poetry and who are familiar with, you know, non-European literature, mainly West African literature, right? And I matched this. It's also difficult to rationalize this, because I matched them, in my opinion. I knew their work, I knew the poets, I knew these translators, so I really matched their sensitivity in my mind, right? And the Italian into English, we had another like three translators doing that. Some Italian poets wanted their own translators. You know, Henry De Luca, who's another major Italian poet, he said, I want to use my translator, Cristina Dieda Lifara. And then, you know, I had to shut up, because, for instance, you know, in the Benny's poem that I edited the book, so if there was something that didn't quite work for me, I talked to the translator. And with the woman who translated that poem, Clarissa Botsford, we had a conversation about this wall for like 2 years, I think. I'm serious. And she said, I want barrier. And then, you know, now that we're talking about walls all the time, it's like, see what you did? Okay, it's your choice. So it's very difficult. There are different levels also in terms of translation. I couldn't intervene on their works. It was fair. She was right. Mm-hmm. Why would I have to say, you know, put Wole there? So in a way, you know, this is why it's important to have this choral narrative, because there's no hierarchy in these voices. They all talk to each other, even in terms of translation, I think, or at least this is what I've tried to do.
Thank you. Yes.
Of course, the question being begged is, where does this stand within the, you spoke of hierarchy, within the general, with a small c, within the general canon of literature as conceived by the Italian establishment?
That's a good question. Do you want to answer that?
I know, you know I know the answer, but we need to talk about that.
No, it's absolutely, it's a fundamental question. And again, what I've tried to do with this book, it was to renegotiate the canon, to mix and match stories. That's why there is Dario Fo, there is Stefano Benni, there is Henry De Luca. You know, Henry De Luca and Stefano Benni, for instance, are, in my opinion, that's why I chose them, like the two extremes of the same spectrum, right? One is very political, very, you know, working class, very proud of being, you know, coming from that background. And the other one is a political satirist, you know, with this cloud in his head, and yet, you know, they can talk about the same theme, diversify, and so in a way they belong to the canon, right? But Fabiano Alborghetti, does he really belong to the canon, or Cristina Alifara, or a bunch of other Italian women poets like Silvia Brea, Annalisa Leva, who were so generous as well, you know, who came and presented the book quite a few times with me and with other people. And I have to say, actually, that it was really interesting to see how they collaborated with one another. We presented this book in December in Rome at the Più Libri Fair, which is, you know, like the mid-size and the small publishing, you know, fair in Rome. It's a huge event, you know. They sell books, they also, you know, make contracts. And the publisher, 66 and Second, which despite the name, 66 and Second is a Roman publisher, Isabella Ferretti, the person who, the publisher herself, she said, we will never be able to have Stefano Benni and Henry De Luca in the same room. And they both said yes, you know, like Stefano said this at the, said yes at the end, the night before. And you can imagine that the room was packed. It was a huge hall. So they were really comfortable with talking also to younger poets and to really create this dialogue. So I think that in that sense, you know, even the idea of canon can be renegotiated, can be deconstructed and reconstructed. And I think it must be done when we talk about very contemporary issues, which are also very socially based, like migration. So I don't know if this answers your question, but this is, you know, my...
This is a question for both of you. My wife and I are filmmakers, and we spent the last 10 years making two films about the Italian immigration, the history of the Italian immigration in the U.S. And what prompted this was the sense that in Italy, when we started working on these films in the early 2000, Italians seem to have almost had an amnesia of the meaning of migrating someplace else. I remember that when I was at the university in Rome in the 70s, I would see small groups of immigrants, small areas where immigrants would gather, particularly near the University of Rome, you know for sure, Eritreans and Ethiopians would gather there. But it was a relatively small number of immigrants. Now, 40 years later, now that so many immigrants are in Italy, how do you think Italians have changed their way of understanding, of relating with the other?
Or their own migration. What was your impression when you were in Italy? Because we talked about this. I mean, my personal opinion is absolutely yes, and I'll. Do you agree, Anthony? They do.
I mean,
yes.
Because I was in Florence in the early 70s, and it seemed that the only foreign students in the universities were from the old Italian colonies, That's what it seemed to me, mm-hmm. that they, because they were allowed to come to Italy and basically study as if they were Italian,
mm-hmm.
so they didn't pay tuition and things of that sort, or they paid whatever was, cinquanta, you know, whatever.
Very little.
Yeah, whatever it was. And that's what I found. And then years later, I noticed, wait a second, they're not just all quote-unquote Ethiopians or Somalians or whatever, but they're actually, they're different people, you know, with them. That's the one thing I noticed. I don't know if you noticed that.
In the 70s, the foreigners, the immigrants that I saw in Italy, in Rome,
mm-hmm.
a lot,
mm-hmm.
were from the former Italian colonies, of course, so Ethiopia, Eritrea, Somalia, but also Filipinos, who
mm-hmm.
came
yeah.
because of the connection
yes.
to the Catholic Church,
yes.
and there were not many other groups. There
mm-hmm.
were no South Asians, there were not other Africans, or very few other Africans. Mm. So what really I was trying to get to was the Italians have obviously had this amnesia for a purpose. They didn't want to remember the poverty and the difficulties that forced 5 million Italians
hmm.
to emigrate to this country, and many others who went to Argentina.
Mm-hmm. But you know, what's also interesting about that history is I think there's also this pocket of, there's an amnesia also in the fact that part of the reason the Mussolini invaded Ethiopia to begin with was because there was an embarrassment for Italy having all these Italians moving here, you know, migrating to the United States or to Argentina.
Right.
However, if you could find a land and call it Italy in Africa, then they could go there and it wouldn't be so much of an embarrassment to have people moving to a different country. So, you know, one of the goals that the fascist army had was to, or the government, claim Ethiopia as Italy, so, and have people move there so they could farm and they could survive. And there was this migration happening. I call it migration. I mean, the army invaded, but people migrated.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you look at Malaparte's, oh, I forget which book, but he speaks of going through different villages in Ethiopia,
mm.
and they're called Bari, you know, I don't know, and then other towns that were given Italian names, and the Italians from those towns in Italy settled in the towns of the same names in Ethiopia. So there is this mirroring that was happening. And I lived in Italy several years ago, and when I would feel the hostility against, you know, anyone who's black or an immigrant, sometimes I would say, oh, come on. We forget 1935, you know, we forget Libya. We forget Eritrea and Somalia. And what was that, if not migration of the poorest into Africa? But we haven't really begun to talk about that part also. And I think that
yeah.
would be an interesting conversation
yeah.
to have.
And there is a double amnesia. There is an amnesia of colonialism, of the
yeah.
very unsuccessful colonial enterprise, and also an amnesia of migration. So it's a double amnesia, and I think it goes on. You know, it's not as bad as it was when I was growing
mm-hmm.
up in the 70s,
mm-hmm.
you know, when in
mm-hmm.
school we didn't learn anything about colonialism, right? It was like a paragraph. And not even about actually the history of Italian emigration. We didn't learn much about that, right? Right.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm from Sicily. I was, you know, born and raised in Palermo. You know, if you go to like some villages around Palermo in the summer, they speak, you know, there are all these young people who speak more American English than Italian, you know, at this point. When I was growing up, now it's changed. But when I was growing up, you know, in the 80s, it still was very much the case. Even Ficarazzi, which is, you know, the gate of Palermo, there is like a huge Italian-American community. We didn't talk about that. And sometimes it's easier to forget than to remember. And I understand, even, you know, before I was, when I was younger and more, you know, political, I was like, this is so wrong. And then, you know, being the daughter of parents in their 90s and asking them about the war, they once told me, and you met them, I told them, why this forgetting? And they told me, you know, sometimes it's too painful. It's exactly what you're saying. You know, we don't want to talk about the war. We don't want to watch war movies, and unless they have a happy end. They were in the war when they were like teenagers, right? So there are traumas, you know, but it's absolutely crucial, I think, personally, to recuperate these stories and to put them in a system with these stories. Mm-hmm. Sometimes, you know, when I talk about migration, you know, I usually talk about migration also because of that, because for every emigrant is always an immigrant, right? And I put, you know, like images from the older Italian-American, or, you know, immigrants from Italy, from Sicily mainly coming to the States, and people from different parts of the basin, of the Mediterranean basin, coming mm-hmm. to Italy. I think it's fundamental. If we don't talk about this, it's not going to make sense. The very last thing I want to say is that this past October, when we were like publishing these books, we had a big festival in Palermo. It's called the Migrant Literary Festival. We had 130 writers from different parts of Europe, some of Africa, a couple of from the United States, and they said, we must organize a panel on the Sicilian migration to the States, to Argentina, to Canada, to Australia. And it was a no, 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 no. I couldn't do it. And I promise, if I want to do something, I go, if I believe in something, I can really, you know, be insistent. But there was no way. They didn't let me do it. The university didn't, the city didn't. They were very supportive otherwise, relatively speaking. But that, they couldn't handle it. So that's... The amnesia is still there, and it's still protected, you know.
Well, also, if you have amnesia, you forget what it's like to be oppressed, and you become the oppressor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's a vicious cycle.
That's why I think that we need to talk about it.
All of us, especially right now in this climate in this country, where we all came here on some boat somewhere, mm-hmm. but yet we forget that, and we are oppressing people who are trying to get it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And it's good that you guys are speaking. You have to remember where you come from and how you got here. Mm-hmm. So that way you turn around and you see somebody else trying to do what you went through.
Yeah.
You have more empathy. There's no empathy anymore in this world. Yeah. The way things are being.
Yeah.
I saw a hand back there.
Thank you very much for your wonderful and knowledgeable and impassioned presentation. So my question is this. What's your next project?
Can I say that? Migration 2.0 with the United States. I really would like to do that. I think that that's really a way to continue the dialogue, hopefully. But that's more than a project, you know, it's at this point, it's an embryo project.
And when you do it, you'll find there's yet another amnesia.
Here.
Children and grandchildren, or grandchildren and great-grandchildren of the immigrants who either don't know or have forgotten about that story, and it never came out so much as at the end of January, the first, when Trump instituted the travel ban, and you'll see.
You said when we do it, right? You didn't say when you do it.
So maybe one last question.
Thank you so much for your presentation. I'm so excited that if what I say doesn't make sense, you will have to pardon me, because this is like just taking in so much. I didn't know that you could listen to people and be high. it starts with the title, right? You gave an anecdote of ORUNMILA at the beginning that I find interesting. I wonder, in your translation, whether you maybe attempt to connect ORUNMILA with Apollo. Because I would say that that's the equivalent in Roman mythology.
Yeah.
And thinking about the way you also did it, you know, connecting Libya with Italy, him to a ball. He talks about how little to give back to a ball was having to go from one, and there was the migrating island. I just find it interesting that, to me, I think it comes down to basically we are all the same.
Yeah.
Boundaries are artificial, borders are artificial, and, you know, the, like I said, if I don't make sense,
yeah.
It goes right back to the first lines of Chris Abani's poem, "There is no native land."
Yeah.
You know, it's all home.
Yeah, and let there be love, because it's really like human solidarity is the only thing that can really help us to transpass boundaries, because on the one hand, there are no borders. On the other hand, there are borders, and there are frontiers, and there are documents, and there are documents that, you know, people do not have. So it's really complex. Orumila, Apollo, and other gods. At the beginning of this book, there is a prologue by Soyinka in which he talks about this, and in which he creates an intertext with a couple of articles from the Declaration of Human Rights, from the chart. And there is also a preface by me in which I really say that, in which I say, you know, every god should be worshipped in the same way. All gods are equal, just like all humans are equal. And in this book, the idea is that dominance shouldn't be there. So it's not only about Christians versus Muslims, Muslims versus Jews. There are so many other religions that can be, you know, thrown in. And it's important to recognize also gods such as Orumila, Apollo, and Maometto, Mohammed, and, you know, Jesus Christ, and Ogun. And these are all, you know, like gods. Everybody needs gods, and they're all, you know, equal if they're not instrumentalized. So thank you for thank this.
You. Thank you.
Thank you, Maaza.